Very good. Ladies and gentlemen, good morning, buongiorno. I hope you are doing well. Very welcome to this digital tasting and overview about our Barolo 2017, the new vintage that has been just released. My name is Fernando Borani and I'm an export manager of Mauro Molino Estate. We are experiencing a difficult period where we cannot travel and explain the new vintage to you in your countries. So this year, to present the new vintage 2017 of Barolo, we have decided to create this digital event, which we serve to embrace all our supporters all over the world. Today, we are also live on Facebook, and this masterclass will be also posted on our YouTube channel and our website. Feel free to ask any question to Martina and Matteo using the Zoom chat or Facebook. Before passing over to my colleague Sara, that we explain about our history, where we are, what we do, I would like to thank you for being a Mauro Molino supporter and watching us today. Sara, the stage is yours.
Hello, everyone, and thanks for being here today. I'm Sara, the person in charge of the hospitality and marketing at Mauro Molino. I know that many of you already know very well the company and the history of the family, but for who is not familiar with us, I would like to give you a few information about the winery. So we are a family company founded by Mauro in 1982. The winery is located in La Morra, one of the most important villages for the production of Barolo. So as you can imagine, our winery is mostly focused on Barolo production, but we also grow and produce other important grape varieties from Piemonte, is to say Arnaiz, Dolcetto, Barbera, and Nebbiolo. Today, the winery is managed by the second generation, Martina and Matteo Molino, Mauro's children, who started in 2003 and 2008, and who brought dynamism and innovation to the company, but without forgetting their tradition. So now I will let them introducing the new vintage and the tasting of the wines.
So if we have to like describe a vintage, in general, it is not never an easy task. That's due mainly because a vintage characterizes all a season long. So like make it in a short way and describe in words, it's very hard sometimes. With the 17 though, and as we do in every year, we start by dividing if a vintage is being like a cool climate oriented or more warm climate oriented. When we are talking about 17, we can definitely say that we are talking about a warm vintage, generally speaking. So what characterized the 17, it's been like warm temperature during the day, but very good excursion of temperature at night. And that made an extremely good acidity and pH in the wine. In fact, if we try the 17 Barolos, so all across the border are very drinkable. And this is one of the first word that I would like to use for describe this vintage. Another characteristics of 17, it's been that is a vintage that have really underlined the unique values of the aromatic across all the range. In fact, in all the range of Barolos, you can recognize a great nose, great expression already right now that they are so young, of course. And the second and most important thing is also that is a vintage that it's been underlining the each individual characteristics of all the single vineyards that we own. For example, just for give you an idea, when we are tasting like our single vineyard Gallinotto, in the nose, it immediately jumps out the herbal notes, the mint, the spiciness, and in the palate, the good complexity. If we go to the Brico Luciani, that is always the most elegant Barolo that we make, what we find is that we have much more like floral approach, like violet and roses notes, with more mineral taste, very straightforward, very direct. Then if we try La Serra, what really comes out is the spiciness, the licorice, the tobacco, and the palate is very profound and very complex. while Conca is completely more austere Barolo with great and big complexity. So 17 can be described in a short way as a incredible drinkable Barolo's style with a fantastic aromaticity value. Now I will pass over the word to my brother Matteo that we go a little bit more deeply into detail about this vintage by showing the evolution in the vineyard, so and kind of transporting you into the vintage more and more.
Thanks, Martina. Hello, everybody. I'm Matteo Molino, co-owner with Martina of Mauro Molino Winery. And I'm more in charge of the winemaking and vinification part. So let's talk in more details about 2017 vintage. Of course, as Martina told, 2017 can be included in a warm vintage for many reasons, because in general, the vintage was with a scarce rainfall, with quite warm temperature in general from winter to the harvest. So of course, we can say it is in the warm side of the vintages we had in the last 20 years. The winter was very, very dry without too much snow and rain. So after the harvest of 16, all the autumn and the winter was quite dry with very beautiful weather. So the agronomic part during the fall was absolutely perfect. I mean, we had time to do everything in the vineyard. The spring really started with some rain, some quite good amount of rain, but the temperature still above the average, warmer than the normal. And it get a very, very fast vegetative development of the plants. The budding was quite early, like 10 days earlier than a normal vintage. And I mean, it was quite a good thing for the harvest, for the vintage, because also the harvest was early. But at the end, the days of the vegetative cycle were not too short. So to be in a hot, in a warm vintage, the days of vegetative cycle were quite long. Everything was a little bit in advance. After the beginning of spring, that was quite rainy, we had a warm and mild end of spring. Since the middle of May, the weather was quite warm. The summer was dry and warm, especially during the day. From the middle of August, the temperature during the night change was much cooler. And I think that part, like many, many years, is absolutely important to characterize the vintage. Why? Because when you arrive at the end of the summer and beginning of September, end of August, beginning of September, the grapes are beautiful, and the climate during that time is really, really important to get aromaticity and drinkability. So also if 2017 was a warm vintage, at the end, this rain at the beginning of September and this temperature range from day and night during the last 3 weeks of the maturation was really the thing that characterized 2017. After the harvest was quite early. We started on 22nd of September and we finish with Conca, and we finish on October 5th with La Serra. So it was 17, 18 days of harvest. So it was not too short, honestly, to be an harvest. But this also was important because respect the time of the single vineyard. One important thing in the warm vintage is that we have no pressure to pick the grapes. So at the end, we can pick the grapes when are ripe, because the weather at the end of September, beginning of October, is normally very, very good. Okay, so this is quite important.
Matteo, if you had to compare 2017 vintage with a previous one, which one would you choose?
Is not always very easy to compare the last the vintage of the last 10 years with other, because with this climate change are quite unique, are quite quite unique characteristic. We have to say that we are living in a perfect moment for the Barolo area, because this climate change is in a moment that really is quite good for Barolo, because Nebbiolo, the grape of Barolo, come from Nebbia, from fog, and now everything is moved a little bit later, so the weather is better until the end of October, so where the harvest is done. But if I have to compare a vintage with 17, I can compare with 2011. Also, maybe was a little bit less warm, but there are some elegance and pleasant that are very, very similar.
And I have another question. I've noticed that from 2015, you started a sort of game, and you started to find a word to describe each vintage. So I remember that you chose balance for 2019 and tension for 2016. For 2017, which word would you choose in order to describe
it? So, Sarah, thanks a lot for the question. So that's, yeah, it's a kind of a fun game of the last years or so to like find a word that can recognize and characterize the vintage. It's also a way to describe in an easy way the vintage itself. So how it works, that me and my brother, we kind of try all the wine of the vintage together. So we share idea and thoughts. The first thing is actually like describe the vintage in general. And then came out with a word that can describe it better. This year, the one that we have chosen, it's been cheerful. That is actually not easy to associate it to a wine, but I think it perfectly describes this vintage, because it's a vintage that is very joyful. So it makes you want to stay with the others, share a glass with the others, especially because the aroma is so immediate and so intense, while also the complexity. So it's cheerful, I guess, is the perfect word for this vintage.
Thank you.
Fantastic. So now I pass to Fernando the word.
Perfect. So I'm checking all the questions. So if everyone has some question, please let us know. Thank you very much, Martina, and thank you very much, Matteo, after this first part, great talking about a few aspects of the 2017 vintage. I would like to introduce you to the second part, which is also for many people probably the most interesting and fun. So let's get started with our wine tasting. Which the first wine of today is our Barolo Classico 2017.
Fantastic. So yeah, this is definitely the most funny part. I have my glass already in my hand. So we can start by talking about the classic Barolo 2017. So if you are familiar with the wine of Mauro Molino, of course you know that the classic Barolo is our ambassador, is the business card of us around the world. And also for the style that this Barolo have, I would say. So the classic Barolo is actually a mix of three different vineyards, and are vineyards that actually are located in three different parts of La Morra. So the classic Barolo, it's coming from the first vineyard, that is the one that you are seeing right now in the picture, that is in the MGA Annunziata. So we are in the lower part of La Morra. It's about 240 meters elevation wise vineyard. And the mention of Annunziata is the one that gives more the elegance and the structure at the wine, at this Barolo. While the second vineyard is also in La Morra area, but is in another part of La Morra. So La Morra is the biggest municipality for production of Barolo. And in fact, the different area makes a huge difference into the wine in terms of characteristics. This second vineyard is in the MGA called Berri. So Berri is in an opposite part compared to Annunziata. So we are in the higher part of La Morra. It's about a 400 meters elevation wise vineyard. And what characterizes Berri is definitely the freshness, the great breeze and the great excursion of temperature between day and night. This is fundamental for this wine because gives to this wine more the flavors and intense aromaticity. It's a very enjoyable wine thanks to Barry, I would say. The third vineyard is the only one that is outside of the La Morra municipality and is in the MGA called Perno. So Monforte d'Alba is actually the area where Perno is located. And as you, most of you for sure know, is also the area that gives more the austerity, the complexity and the grip to the wine. So I guess the La Morra and Monforte area into this wine melts up very well. In terms of aging, the classic Barolo is aged for 18 months in large barrels, all used barrels. So the idea is to make more a traditional style of Barolo with keeping the purity of the grapes and the vineyards itself. But let's have a taste about this wine. So if we smell the classic Barolo 17, to me, what is very immediate is, again, the word cheerful. This is probably the most pleasant amount of all the other Barolos that we are making in this vintage, because the nose is very, very enjoyable already. It's very like fruits, fresh aroma, like ripe fruits and cherry notes, I can feel. And then if we taste it, we do have a great complexity, but extremely well-balanced tanning. This is definitely a wine that can easily be enjoyed right now. So it's a wine very gastronomic. And I guess the 17 perfectly represent the style of the classic Barolo.
So after describe the classico, let's move to the single vineyards. For us, single vineyards are very, very important. First of all, what means single vineyard? Single vineyard means that all the grapes that we use for to make a wine that you see the name on the label come from that vineyard. We make four different single vineyards, and historically our goal is to make vineyard from La Morra. La Morra is the biggest commune in terms of hectares in the Barolo area, and is also the higher altitude. So you can imagine how many different microclimate and vineyard there are. So what we try to exalt is the difference between the different vineyard. Exalt the characteristic of the terroir. This is extremely, extremely important. And at the end, there are people who prefer one single vineyard, people prefer another, but the most important thing is try to be to follow the what the single vineyard get us. So let's start with the first single vineyard in the line is the Gallinotto. So Gallinotto single vineyard, Gallinotto is a single vineyard in the MGA Berry. Berry is a single vineyard in the southwest side of La Morra that has some very, very interesting characteristic. The first is the location, because Berry is at the border of the Barolo area, is a southwest exposition, and the vineyard is just in front to the Italian Alp. So when we work in the vineyard, we see just in front of us, if the day is a beautiful and clean sky day, the Alp. And the beauty is that there is nothing between the Alp and the vineyard. So there is no barrier that protect the vineyard. That's very important because especially with this warm summer and 2017, of course, the summer was very warm. The breeze, especially during the night, refresh the vineyard and gets the characteristic of the wine. Gallinotto was a vineyard both by our father in 1996. And a part of this vineyard was replanted there, so it's 25 years old, and a part is 45 years old. It's 1 hectare and a half, and the production is 9,000 bottles per year. Let's taste the wine. What we recognize when we taste Gallinotto is the first, the color. The color of Gallinotto is normally a little bit darker than the other single vineyard we make for two reasons. The first one is the altitude, so more fresh, more color. And the second one is the soil, because that area has a little bit less sandy soil and a little bit more clay and calcareous, and a little limestone also. The nose really characterize, is very characteristic, has a lot of mint, eucalyptus, some red fruit, spicy, quite a very good deepness. And the mouth is rich, is full, but at the same time is very, very enjoyable and very pleasant. I mean, it's still very young, but I think it's still quite good drinkable. And that's really the characteristic also of the vintage.
Matteo, if I'm not wrong, Gallinotto is giving you a lot of satisfactions and results in the last years. So many people started to appreciate it a lot. And I would like to know, why do you think it is performing so well so lately?
I think it's performing very well at the moment for the reason I told. I mean, for because it's higher, and every area is every wine area in the world in the last 10 years is try to move a little bit to the high altitude. And when our father Mauro Boffi in 96, our father was an agronomic for many, many years and has a passion about the vineyard, really has a good vision to buy 3.5 because part of Gallinotto we use also for the Barolo Classico in this high elevation side, because with this climate change is becoming very, very, very important to us to have vineyard in the high altitude part of the area.
And so do you think that Gallinotto will be performing better and better in the future?
Of course, yes, for two reasons. The first reason is the one I told. I mean, climate change, warmer, and late bad weather during the autumn. And the second one is that is getting also older the plants. So older plants normally make better wine. That's for sure a very important thing.
Thanks.
You're welcome.
Great. After the description of Gallinotto, let's move to the second single vineyard, that is Bricolucciani. So Bricolucciani is a very important vineyard for Mauro Molino Winery. So it's actually the vineyard right in front of our estate. The pink building in the picture is our winery, and Bricolucciani is just in front of it. We always considering Bricolucciani like the backyard of our estate. It's also been part of the property since the beginning. So in this case, we are talking about 48 years old vines average. In fact, my grandfather Giuseppe bought this vineyard together with the property in the early 50s. When we are talking about Bricolucciani, we are talking about a very small vineyard. You can also find the number of bottles produced on the label. So we are making 4,517 bottles in vintage 2016-17. So this is a very small vineyard. It's really an authentic niche. In fact, we are talking about zero, less than a hectare size, so it's about 0.7 hectare. Bricolucciani is actually in La Morra. We are back in the lower part of La Morra, so in the Annunziata area. The elevation is roughly 240 meters altitude. And what characterized this vineyard, you can slightly see in the picture as well, on the left hand of the vineyard, the type and the color of the soil that is much more light, very mineral, So it's mainly like marlstone soil with a little percentage of sandy inside. It's about 20%. But the sandy soil percentage into this vineyard is what makes the huge difference from Brico Luciani to the rest of the range, because gives to this wine the great minerality, freshness, and longevity, but at the same time also the aromaticity that is very, very, very particular and intense. So in terms of vinification, this wine see 18 months for half used barrique and for half barrels of 30 hectoliters. But let's taste the wine. So the first thing that I always like very much about Brico Luciani is the nose. So it's a very delicate, very gentle expression of Barolo. At this stage, you can appreciate these flower notes. So to me, it's very like violet, like petal notes. It's giving a lot. So it's already very, very expressive in terms of aromaticity. Then if we try it, we can see that the difference between Brico Luciani and Gallinotto is very pronounced. So in this case, the tannins are still quite present, quite young. But at the same time, what I really like into this wine is that it's very direct, so very straightforward. I like the minerality, the things that make you drink another glass. So it's this is to me what Brico Luciani 17 is right now.
Martina, you mentioned that Brico Luciani is the closest vineyard that you have to the winery. So my question is, what is your relationship with this vineyard so close to where you have been living all your life?
So that's a fantastic question, because of course Brico Luciani, as I said before, it's been basically our garden for our entire childhood, you know? So represent a lot to us. I remember perfectly myself like playing in this vineyard during the harvest time. So to me, Brico Luciani is always exalting good memories. So I have a perfect affection to this winery. And that's why it's also my personal favorite single vineyard.
So let's go back to high altitude vineyard and move to La Serra. So La Serra represents the last single vineyard we started to make. We started to make La Serra in 2010 only, and is the only single vineyard that we are not owner of the land, but we rent the land. So we do all the work, but we have a contract with the lucky owner of this vineyard. And I tell you a story. When in 2010, during the winter 2010, the owner of La Serra, that is a very good friend of our father Mauro, called our father one night and say, "Hey, I have this very small piece of La Serra. Serra is only 0.4 hectare, so it's a very, very, very small single vineyard. And if you want, I know you like vineyard, you work with passion in the vineyard. If you want, I can rent you for a long time." At that time, we had three single vineyards, so we didn't know how to do. And we get to the Cantina Comunale, the wine shop in La Morra, and we get a few La Serra just to taste. We tasted many times La Serra, but just to have an idea, a general idea of the single vineyard. And we taste all this La Serra, and we were really, 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 really impressed by the nose, by the deepness of this vineyard. And we're still in love with this vineyard for that reason, because La Serra is a very high altitude single vineyard. Our vineyard is close to 400 meters, so very, very high, but in the southwest side of La Morra. It's just up to Brunate and Cerecchio, in front to Barolo, the village of Barolo, and the vineyard is very, very protected. The age of the plants is older than 40 years old, and is always a land that gets at the wine an incredible energy and an incredible identity. When you taste La Serra and you smell the nose, you feel a lot of spicy, the clove, the cinnamon, a lot of fruit, some mint. But the beauty of all the Barolos, but especially the real complex Barolo, as La Serra is the evolution in the glass. So if you taste and taste after 10 minutes, after 50 minutes, I mean, the sensation is still the same, but with a different evolution. That's really the beauty of Barolo, I think. And we pour the wine in the glass like 1 hour ago, and really the evolution now in the glass is absolutely incredible. Same thing are in the mouth. The mouth of La Serra is very direct, is very rich, has a lot of tension. The wine from Annunziata, Brico Luciani and Conca are maybe more round, more rich in terms of volume, but La Serra is more direct because the altitude gets this freshness. What I like in 17 about La Serra is the warm sensation that normally are not easy to find because it's very, very high. So in 17, that was a little bit warmer, you find this silky palate, this elegance, this harmony, and it's really, really balanced. Balance and gets me a lot of emotion. La Serra was aged for 18 months in 90% used barrique and 10% new barrique. And the production is around 2,700 bottles. So it's a very, very small production, but it represents another paint, another characteristic of a single vineyard for our range of single vineyard. So it's still a very, very important single vineyard for us.
So after La Serra, let's go to the top. Let's try Conca. So Conca is, I'm very proud of, first of all, to speak about Conca because Conca is our masterpiece. So is the flagship of our estate. And mainly for two reasons. So because Conca is actually the reason why my grandfather in the early 50s bought the property. So that proves how important this single vineyard was already back in the days. The second reason is because my father started to make wine with Conca. So his first wine was Barolo Conca. It's great in this case to have the picture of the vineyard because there is no words that can describe it better than a picture in this case. As you can see, Conca is a very particular vineyard shape-wise. So it's shaped as a concave. So it's basically like an half circle. I describe it like as a small amphitheater. So that gives you a very good idea of how the vineyard looks like. The vineyard is a very small plot. It's like a 2-hectare size, split between three different owners. And our own part is the center of the amphitheater. So the one best exposed, that means more south facing. The size of the vineyard, our own size, is 0.3 hectares. In fact, out of that, we make roughly 3,000 bottles a year. So this is a very, very small vineyard production-wise. Conca is actually the neighborhood vineyard of Brico Luciani. To me, what gives you really the idea of how different a single vineyard is from one from the other is in our case, to pair close to each other Brico Luciani and Conca, because there are basically neighborhood vineyards. There is like 400 meters far away. They are 400 meters far away from each other, but they are completely different in style. This is due mainly to the exposure, because the soil type also in Conca is mainly calcareous soil with a little percentage of sandy soil, a little bit smaller compared to Brico Luciani. But in this case, Conca is more in the valley, while Brico Luciani is on the top of the hill.
In fact, for give you an idea of how they perform, I tend usually to say that Bricolucciani is the most feminine part of the hill, while Conca is definitely more the masculine part, and also in style that that you can find in the wine. So Conca is aged exactly the same way as La Serra, so is 18 months in 90% used barrique and 10% new oak. So let's try the Conca 17 together. So Conca is always maybe a little bit more shy at the beginning. This is due to the potential of the vineyard itself. It's definitely a long aging wine, but I like Conca 17 at this stage. I like it because I can recognize very intense ripe fruits notes, but at the beginning. But then if you smell it after some time and you give to this one some time, you can find more the spiciness, the chocolate, the leather, that is always very characteristic sensation in this vineyard. So then if we try the Conca, this is where you can find really the complexity of the vineyard. So because Conca is always very, very full body wine, very big in the mouth. So it's a very emotional vineyard. And I think the 17 is performing very, very well because we do have the deepness of the single vineyard, but at the same time, the soft tanning and the round tanning.
Perfect.
So Martina, as I was able to understand, the last two Barolos, so La Serra and Conca, comes from very old vineyards, but La Serra is the history of the Barolo, since it's one of the most important and famous mentioned in La Morra, while Conca is important for the history of the family. So I would like to ask you, what is the emotional bond that links Mauro to this vineyard?
Okay, so this is a very important question because this vineyard, for my father, it's been everything. So it's been really the history, as you said, of our winery. It's true. So it's the first wine that he started to make in 1882. Is also kind of a light that guided our path of winemaking, because when my father started, he started right away with a single vineyard. So he had already clear in his mind how important was to vinify, separate the vineyard and not blend them together. And that's really the most important thing for our winery. Not only, the first wine that he started to make was Conca, but right after Bricolucciani, in the 90s, he invested again on a single vineyard for making Gallinotto. So really, the Conca is so, so important to us.
Perfect. That's great. Thank you, Martina. Thank you, Matteo.
Thanks a lot.
So we have a few questions that from our public today. Maybe the first one could be from Andres Sosa, that asking about if 2017 could be recognized as outstanding vintage.
So that's a good question. So if it can be recognized as an outstanding vintage. So what I can say is that I have to be fair. In the last years or so, we got very lucky in the Barolo area. And we did have several good vintages. We didn't have any bad one at the exception of maybe two. The others were quality level was very good. So then the 17 is in between two exceptional vintage that are 16 and 18 that is going to be phenomenal. I don't think that 17 is maybe the vintage, but is definitely one of the vintage that you would like to have in your cellar and try it. Because to me, I guess that the 17 have the unicity to be so enjoyable, so emotional right away, and is an exceptional way maybe to the people that are quite beginner into the Barolo. So because it's extremely accessible, very enjoyable at the moment, you can either keep it but drink it right away. So I don't think it's probably the most exceptional vintage ever. I'm not honest to say that, but it's definitely a vintage that you should have and you should try, because it has some unicity that other vintages doesn't have. I will pass to Matteo if there is other questions.
Sure. Yeah, so hi Matteo, there is another question from Soren Vestergaard. I'm sorry for my pronunciation. What's the best service temperature, you know, to serve our wines, to serve Barolo? What do you think?
But, in general, in the past, it was very usual to serve Barolo quite warm, but I think it was quite wrong. I mean, what I recommend is to serve Barolo in a temperature between 15 to 17 degrees, not more, for one reason, because Barolo has a complexity. So, and when it's cool, when a wine from cold is becoming warm, exalt all the perfume. I mean, all the perfume come on the glass. And the second reason is that a wine, when it's served for a lunch or dinner or tasting with some friend, is getting warm very, very fast. So get it a little bit too cold, I think is the best way.
Okay, thank you. There is another question from Fabrizio from Milano. And is asking, what does it mean a long time of renting? I think he's talking about La Serra Vineyards.
But it's since 10 years that we have, so we hope for another 20 years.
That's for sure. So there is a question about, I think I'm hearing that 2017 is a vintage to drink now. Why waiting for 2016 to mature? Is that a valid statement? Is that true?
Yeah, yeah, it's true. I mean, the beauty of Barolo is that every vintage is really, really different. So taste a new vintage of Barolo is always get something emotional, something that I think is very important. Like Martina told, 17, of course, is not 16. 16, for me and for us, was one of the best vintage of ever. But at the same time, with that kind of vintage, you have not always the perfect occasion, because our vintage that need more time. 17 is a very beautiful vintage, very enjoyable, very drinkable, and still have a lot of complexity. I mean, it's not an easy vintage. It's a very complex vintage and get a lot of emotion in the young part of the life. But never forget that it is a vintage that can age for quite a long time. Eh? It's not a vintage that you must drink in 2 years. So it's a vintage that can age for quite a long time. I pass to Martina if you have any other questions.
Yes. Okay, Martina, I have another interesting question. I don't know if we can say anything about that, but do you have any new plans to making some new single vineyards in the future?
So single vineyards, no, but you kind of read our minds. So there is new plans coming up. So stay tuned and you will discover which one we are talking about.
Okay. And then there is an Italian question, but I can say in English from Corrado Fumagalli. What could be the best food, the wine pairing, you know, the best food pairing with our 2017 Barolo?
That's a good question. So actually, I like to pair the Barolos in general, usually more with meat, so like braised veal or like steak or something like that. But for the 17, I did it personally, I think a very good pair, a part of meat in general, is cheeses. So it's performing very well with cheese. So really, the refineness of the tanning really came out with cheeses.
Okay. Another question is from Francesco Gabriele, and in asking who influenced your style of Barolo, if any has influenced your style of Barolo.
So that's another good one. Of course, at the beginning, somebody have to influence, you know? So, and I think the one that really most influenced us is our father, because so it's been always a light to us from the beginning. I think maybe at the beginning for him as well, there were many producers that he knew very well, and they used to like kind of co-work together, share ideas, develop an history that when he first started wasn't written yet. So especially like when we are talking about 40 plus years ago, the Barolo area was a completely different area. So everything was to build up from the beginning. So like it is still very important now, but probably more back in the days, like taste, experiment, shares idea with others was a very, very important thing. And then to us now, of course, at the beginning and still right now, our father is very important, but is always very important also to us to continue to taste and improve quality-wise our winemaking style.
Okay. Returning to the question of the food pairing.
Yeah, I will pass to Matteo so he can now answer him about the food.
Okay, Matteo, so returning to the question of the food pairing, Lorenzo Noia is asking if any specific cheese that you could recommend from Piemonte.
With Barolo, of course, what is the best pairing is some aged cheese, like Castelmagno, that's our perfect. Braduro, if it's aged. I mean, that's absolutely perfect.
Okay, and from Andres Sosa, he's asking about Conca 2017. When do you think it will reach the full maturity?
is always very, very difficult to say that, because of course the first thing is that Conca is a vineyard that for characteristic as is easy for the wine for Conca to age for a long time because they're very rich. It's very old vineyard. So very old vineyard gets a lot of balance since the beginning. And when a Barolo is very balanced since the beginning, can age for a very, very long time. So I think in a good vintage can age for 35, 40 years. But is always very, very beautiful to see the evolution of the Barolo and taste in the future, because we have a private cellar and where we keep all the old vintage that Mauro did. And sometime when we are together, we get a bottle and we taste a bottle. And the best surprise were many times from maybe a vintage that we didn't consider the best, like 94, like 95. And that's really surprising us, because this is an area where the soil has a lot of potential, has a lot of richness, and gets a lot of complexity to the wine that you find early when it's young, but you find more when the wine is old. So can age for a very long time, I'm sure.
Okay. Maybe I have a question for you both. Why do you think we should maybe buy a couple of bottles 2017 in our cellar? So maybe buy Barolo Classico and Gallinotto and moving to La Serra and Conca. So what do you think about that, and why should we have at least a couple of different bottles 2017?
But I mean, I think the one is very personal for myself. So everybody like one style, so can choose the single vineyard. But people can have 17, can drink 17 for two reasons. The first reason is because it's an enjoyable vintage, and get a lot of emotion in the young part of the life. And doesn't mean not later, but in the young part of the life is very enjoyable, this aromaticity, this elegance, these flowers, I mean, the complexity and the pleasant sensation that get. And the second one is because in an area like Barolo is very, very important for me, because I'm, first of all, I'm a winemaker, but first of all, I'm wine passionate, to taste the different vintages just to see how the climate is important to get the characteristic of the wine, but at the same time, also the vineyard is important. So if you taste different vintage of the same vineyard, I think the beauty is at the end, find one direction, one characteristic. So it's for these two reasons that I think everybody can taste and have 2017.
That's great. I mean, I don't think there are other questions. And so I'm heading by our greetings, final greetings of today. Personally, I want to thank you, everyone that has been watching us today on this great masterclass. And I hope we can visit you soon in your country. And thank you very much again. I will pass it over to Sara for the final greetings.
So thank you very much for being here with us. And I hope you enjoyed the presentation. And I hope to see you soon at the winery. Thank you. Grazie mille.
Thank you so much to everybody and cheers. See you soon. Ciao. Bye bye.